It's interesting when you look at the longer term divergence in what market participants are expecting. Right? There's very much that pricing in of rate cuts by the time we get to the second half, and the expectation that the move off the peak is going to be faster. Do you think there's mispricing going on there?
Yeah, it's an interesting question, isn't it? I mean, it's no surprise to say everyone's going to go up this week, but where do they peak out and how long do they hold it for? Actually, for me, that's the big question for next year. And it's all about that pricing behaviour. I'll be paying really close attention to that CPI print that we get on Tuesday for the US, particularly the core inflation month on month. That's the one that tells you how that pricing pressure is moving in real time or near real time. They're going to need to see that slowing down. If it comes at 0.3%, which is where markets are expecting, that's still comfortably above what it needs to be consistent with a 2% inflation rate. That's going to have to slow down quite a lot, quite quickly next year for them to peak in, say, Q1, maybe Q2, and then to be coming back down by the time to the second half of the year. So I do think, if anything, it's a longer hold from them once they hit their peak than the markets are currently expecting. But I absolutely expect to be talking about rate cuts this time next year, if not already seeing them in action.
Right. And if that is then coupled with the impact of a fuller China reopening, is there still the hope that China's economy again plays that counter-cyclical growth force next year? There's so much we don't know about how the reopening is carried out, what happens to the property market, and so on and so forth.
Absolutely. I mean, I think if they do manage to reopen and get the economy going again, and they lift their growth rate from about 3% this year to maybe into the fours, maybe even touching 5, then naturally that is going to be a counter-cyclical growth story, and it'll be very helpful for the world economy. It's interesting this year, right, that they were in the doldrums when the rest of the world was booming. If they'd also been booming, we'd have had a much bigger inflation problem.
Will it still be a big inflation problem, though, next year?
Well, therein lies the question, and how that balance goes. And, of course, their reopening and moving away from zero COVID in particular should help to relieve some of the price pressures, because it should help to bring some of those supply chain disruptions down even further. They've come off a lot, but they're still pretty elevated compared to pre-COVID. So I think we'll just have to see how that dynamic plays through. But, again, I think it's something that we'll know in the first half of the year, and then we'll have a pretty clear steer for the second half of the year. There's a lot to happen between, say, Jan 1st and maybe the end of April that will really dictate how next year looks in my mind.
Sarah, because we're even hearing from Goldman Sachs that perhaps China will not exit COVID zero until at least April. So if they do exit, what's the base case for KPMG on how you really factor in all of this booming Chinese demand that we're expecting?
Well, it's certainly a challenge. And I think also we've got to be clear on what do we mean by exit zero COVID. There's an awfully long way from a really, you know, tough COVID stance where you get a couple of cases and you put, you know, entire cities into lockdown, through to absolute free movement. We no longer test. We no longer require people to isolate and all of those other sort of shifts that we've seen in most countries now. So I think it's going to be a gradual process. I don't think anyone expects them to just sort of snap their fingers and it to change overnight. In terms of how it flows through into China's economy and then into the rest of the world, it's worth keeping in mind that so much of what's in the doldrums in China right now is domestically oriented activity. It's consumer based, it's services. So that as a stimulus to the rest of the world is indirect. It's not as if they're going to be sucking in imports from elsewhere to service that demand. But having said that, you know, if they are looking at reopening manufacturing sector, allowing, as I said earlier, that supply chain disruption to normalize, then that is a positive, particularly for those Asian countries that are locked into that supply chain. So I think we're going to have to, as ever, wait and see how it plays through. But I think being cautious on what that reopening looks like and means for everyone else, it's good news in that they're not a drag anymore and it will spill over. But I don't think it's going to be a stimulus like what we saw after the GFC, which obviously did ripple through the global economy and it was a real driving force for a few years.
How concerning is the fact that we're seeing trade flows now starting to ease and slow down? We saw that with China's trade numbers recently. We are getting Korea's 10-day trade numbers in a few minutes as well. In Japan this week.
Yeah, I mean, and those ones are the bellwether. We all hang on the Korea numbers because they're very timely and they are a really good predictor for what's going on through the global trade cycle. And inevitably, the trade cycle is going to slow. We're already seeing reports in some of the more swingy parts of it, like semiconductors, that they've moved very much from oversupply into balance and probably going into, undersupply into balance and going into oversupply next year. And I think we should expect more of that. Trade always swings. We know global momentum is easing. We know that part of the story happening right now is a continued pivot pivot away from spending on goods by households back towards services. If you put all of that together, it's clearly a pretty challenging environment for trade right now. The only exception I can see, maybe a bit of a bright spot, is around autos, cars, but that's really because their supply chains have been so disrupted for so long. There's still a really big pipeline backlog of orders that they're trying to work through. But outside of that, I do think we'll see a downturn. It's sort of inevitable given where the cycle is right now.
Is the outlook or the likelihood of a soft landing in Australia getting a little bit better if we do see that acceleration in China? You see the positivity across iron ore pricing, for example. Mm-hmm.
It's certainly not... it's going to help, right? Because there's a lot of domestic headwinds we know are going to slow the economy right down. I think for me, I'm encouraged by it through two channels. One, because it will mean we'll get that services exports recovering, not just the tourists, but the students as well. They'll be able to leave and actually travel here. But also, two, China's a major source of migrants into Australia, part of which are the students. If they're able to come here, be it spending through the economy, but also supplying labour into the economy, then that's a real positive for Australia for next year. So I do think it could have a nice help for the RBA if we see those kind of movements return.